To the end of vlog sewing for men, my Thread Theory Goldstream coat review and some other makes all for men. Good morning, beautiful people. I'm Alex and this is Gingerhead & Co, my sewing vlog. And today I'm going to talk about sewing for men. I'm not sure if you sew for men, but I sew for my husband mainly. I like sewing for men. I know that there aren't that many vlogs showing makes for men. I know that fewer men than women have a vlog about sewing. Today's video is going to be all about sewing for men, mainly because I wanted to review a pattern, Thread Theory Goldstream coat. It took me a while to make it. And it was my first tailored coat. I've got some other makes all for men to show you. Makes that I can put in any other vlog. I kind of sew quite a lot and sometimes I forget to show you things and sometimes I just think that I repeat, so maybe you don't need to see all of them. But let's start with the most important thing. I've made a man's coat and it's my first coat for a man. It's for my husband, Chubby. I was slightly apprehensive. I got the fabric. If you watch my vlogs, you might remember the fabric. I've got some wool from M. Rosenberg & Son, and it was in London Knitting and Stitching Show this year. I loved the fabric. It doesn't really look much. That's the coat, by the way. And I know that my mannequin has a bra because it's my mannequin. Let's try and cover the bra. So the fabric might not look terribly exciting in the video, but it's really nice. It's really thick, really heavy, really good quality. And I didn't want to destroy the fabric by experimenting on it, so I did follow the instructions, mostly. But let me first tell you about the pattern because I'm not sure if you know what pattern it is. So I've got the pattern with me. It's, as I said, Thread Theory Goldstream Pea Coat. It's from Parkland's collection and there are two views to this pattern. I'm going to insert some drawings because mine was PDF, so I've got it printed out, but probably not showing very well on camera. The pattern itself gives you simple instructions. It's not a very difficult pattern as such, but Thread Theory on their website have a tutorial how to make it more tailored. So they include everything, all the descriptions of how to interface it, how to mold the color and all of that. And I must say that the tutorial itself was absolutely brilliant. I absolutely loved it. And I didn't even expect to love it so much. It gave me a lot of pleasure to, first of all, read and research into tailoring because I had no idea about tailoring. I still don't really know much about tailoring. It's just such a vast subject. But I loved it. And I would definitely recommend, even if you don't want to do the tailored version, I would recommend you to go to Thread Theory website and have a read, have a look at it. They also have a special dedicated page with all the resources, like books and blogs, and I think there aren't any vlogs, but I don't remember, that talk about tailoring, talk about making coats. They're absolutely marvelous. And once you start reading about it, you kind of carry on. Most of the things that I read were free. I've learned a lot. I watched a lot of videos. I just got so hooked up and I couldn't stop watching. So let's talk a bit about how the pattern looks like. It's a double-breasted coat. There are two views. So one is with a hood. The other one just has a collar. The back is two parts. It's fully lined and it's got buttons. It's got simple patch pockets. It's not terribly difficult and it's a good thing to start with this coat. I would definitely recommend it. The instructions in the pattern are very, very clear. It wouldn't be very difficult to make, apart from the fact that making a coat is generally slightly more difficult. I think Kate from the Fold Line said something about coats that they're not that much more difficult than making a dress. They are for me. I don't know. She's got loads of experience, so probably for her it doesn't really matter if it's a coat or if it's a dress. If you line it, you know, it's pretty much the same. For me, it does matter. Coats are more difficult and more time consuming for me. I've been sewing for 2.5 years and for me it's still quite new. I don't know a lot of things. I don't understand certain processes. For the ones of you, and I know you are there, who are extremely experienced, it might be true that making a coat is not a big challenge, but for people like me, it still is. It takes quite a lot of thinking, quite a lot of measuring, cutting out with precision. I'm just scared that if it goes wrong, I'm going to lose a lot of time. I'm going to waste a lot of money in fabric, and I wouldn't want that. So I was very careful when making the coat. It worked. I had some problems. Of course, I was swearing a lot. There was quite a lot of very unpleasant conversations with my sewing machine. But all in all, it was quite enjoyable. I don't like hand sewing, but because I've watched so many videos about tailoring, I've learned so many things and I understood why I was doing that, and it didn't really bother me. I had some problems with interfacing, or rather, I had some problems with deciding what interfacing to use, because this is the first coat, as I said, that I've made for Hedge Hubby. I made a muslin, but it was a muslin made of some cheap polyester fabric, and I thought there was enough room for interfacing, for the lining. But then as I started sewing, I panicked and I thought my interfacing was really thick and the fabric is thick, and I thought it was not going to work because it was going to suddenly become too small. The coat was going to suddenly become too small. I was wrong, but I found out about being wrong after I finished the coat, because it's absolutely fine and I could have used the thicker interfacing. I unpicked all the interfacing that I spent 2 days putting in, and I put in another sewn in by hand. It's only basting, it's not very difficult, but it's just time consuming. Well, I put another one in that was thinner. It's pretty much like canvas. That was the first time I molded the collar. That was the first time I put interfacing in the chest area. That was the first time I heard about interfacing that is different for the chest area, for various parts of the coat, that you've got different thicknesses and different purposes. It was fascinating to learn about all those processes, all the reasons for using various things, like even the simple shoulder pads. They can be placed in different positions and it really changes the shape of the, well, of the man. It changes the shape of the shoulder, and it changes how, not just how symmetrical it becomes, but also generally you can sort of play with the shoulder pads to have bigger shoulders or kind of more balanced silhouette. And I think it's brilliant, because I didn't really believe it. I didn't really like, well, that was the first time I put shoulder pads in anything, because I don't like shoulder pads, and it's just this kind of, you know, leftover image from the 80s, power shoulders and all that. But they work, and you buy special tailoring shoulder pads, so you can manipulate them. You can make one slightly thinner, usually not perfectly symmetrical. So one shoulder can be higher, one shoulder slightly lower. Sometimes you can notice it straight away. Sometimes you just need to investigate a bit further. And it was fun, and I really had fun. And I would definitely recommend that pattern or starting a bit of tailoring to anyone. It's so fulfilling. It gives you so much satisfaction. I had terrible problems with buttonholes, and that was also the first time ever in my life. Well, my machine, I've got a Juki machine, has never had any problems with buttonholes, so much so that I didn't really understand when people were talking about problems with buttonholes, because my buttonholer is automatic and you can program your machine to do a buttonhole in whatever shape and size you want, and I've never had a problem. That was the first time when buttonholes weren't working. The fabric is really thick. The fabric is thick in itself. Then it's interfaced. Then you've got interlining. That's a lot of fabric. The coat was so heavy that it didn't really matter. I don't have that much space, but it didn't really matter how I placed it. I used the extension table, but it didn't really matter much. It was still pulling a bit. So every time I did a sample, it was beautiful. And then I tried to do it on the coat and it wasn't as beautiful as I wanted it to. I nearly cried. I spent 2 days kind of practicing various buttonholes, and I'm definitely not at the stage where I can make a buttonhole by hand that would look beautiful. It would look awful. So, I didn't even attempt to do that. Finally, I've got buttonholes. I'm not perfectly happy with them because of all the unpicking. And you know that, well, if you unpick something, it does damage the fabric slightly. So I'm not 100% happy, but I'm happy with the coat, and I'm happy that it's finished and it's done. And I'm very proud of it. I'm sure that any tailor having a look at it would probably find like 10,000 things that are not perfect. But I don't care. I'm still extremely proud. Hedge Hubby loves it. It fits him really well. He looks good. He's got really broad shoulders, and it's a funny thing because he's quite a skinny bloke. He's a tall skinny bloke, but he's got really broad shoulders. So I didn't want to accentuate that, and I was trying to make it more balanced. Although now when I think about it, well, he's my husband. He's my type. I like men with broad shoulders, so I don't know. But I had a lot of fun. He didn't really have a lot of fun trying the coat on because he's a typical bloke and he doesn't really understand the importance of trying things on. Also, what I've learned about tailoring, that the word bespoke is only used in tailoring is the client has had some input into making it. So it's made to his requirements. He chooses the fabric or the notions or whatever. So this is bespoke. I decided finally on the fabric, but he had something to say about it. He chose the lining, the buttons and everything. Well, he had a lot to say about how it fits. So it's definitely bespoke. And also, I made a joke about it on Instagram. If I ever die and Hachabi marries again, his wife will have to change all his wardrobe, buy him everything from scratch. Everything I make for him replaces the ready-to-wear things that he's got. He likes the things that I make, which is really flattering. So I made a joke that everybody would know that I was married to him. And something that I'm not sure if people understood, that it's my equivalent of weeing on something, because, well, I'm a dog person, so I've got two dogs, but I generally spend a lot of time with dogs, various dogs, because of my charities. Dogs, when they want to appropriate something or when they want to make sure that everybody knows it belongs to them, they wee on it, right? Because I wanted everybody to know that I made the coat, I put my labels in. I'll show you the close-up of the coat. Now my girl is going to show her bra and all that. I'm not sure if you do that on your body form, but without the bra, my things don't really fit. So to use my just to fit something, I have to put a bra on. Do you do that? I'm sure I've seen it, somebody doing that as well. Well, okay, back to the coat. So that's the coat. I put one label here on the pocket that is inside. So that's the lining that Hachabi decided he wanted. It's fine. The lining is from the textile center. So that's my label. There is another label. So I've got the label here as well. The coat has epaulettes and epaulettes. The buttonholes were just impossible to make. That was really difficult. Then the straps on the sleeves as well. And then it's got pockets. It is really heavy. The pockets are lined. I really like the finishes. And another thing that I've learned is, you know, the buttons that are on the other side of the garment, they are called stays, like stays in your waistband. They have the same function, so they kind of make sure that there is a balance, and when you pull the button, it doesn't come off easily. And I made them purple to match the lining, and I really like it, and I think it's like those little cute things make our clothes more our. I like the kind of personal touches. It really is very heavy, so I'm going to put it back on the mannequin. I'll try to insert some photos because I know that you can't really see it very well. Well, I love it. I'm very happy. I'm not sure if I'm going to make anything like that anytime soon, but I'm definitely very happy with this one. And it's going to be a Christmas present because I spent so much time making it that it needs to be special. I think it is special. I think Hachabi really loves it and it is special. He knows that he's going to get it, so it's like an extra present for Christmas. Nonetheless, I decided that it is making its way under the tree because that's just too much time, too much energy, too much effort to be just given to him like that. Okay, I'm quickly going to show you some other makes for Hachabi that I didn't manage to put in any other video. So when I was in London, I also bought Alexander Henry quilting cotton with Frida Kahlo, right? I'm not sure if you remember. And I said that I was going to make a shirt for Hachabi. So that's the shirt. It is already slightly crumpled because I think he's worn it. I said that I had to like remove certain markings and clip the threads, but I think it's already had it on. I didn't have a chance to show you because I just didn't show you. But that's the shirt. The pattern is with Simplicity 8427, and I've used it loads of times. And I really like this pattern. I have adapted the pattern. So in the pattern, the sleeves are always long, but Hachabi likes short sleeves, so I've changed the sleeves. I usually make a yoke from a different fabric when the print is that big, because it's very, very difficult not to cut off somebody's head. And also, it just looks better. And he loves his shirts. I like it, so that matters. I do certain parts of top stitching using my cover stitch machine, because I think it looks pretty regular. It looks really nice, like at the back of the yoke. I don't know if it's going to look straight, because sometimes I'm surprised how things look in the video, but it is very straight. And I hem the sleeves with the cover stitch. The hem is done using a cover stitch. It just very quick and easy, and it's again full of my cat's hair, but if I don't show it to you now, I'm never going to show it to you. I'll try to put some photos of him. He loves the shirt, I love the shirt. I kind of regretted not leaving the fabric to make something out of it for myself, because I like the fabric so much. But to be honest, I don't really like wearing dresses that I need to press before wearing, or I need to spend a lot of time pressing before I can put them on. I don't like ironing. I wouldn't wear a dress made out of this fabric as often as it should be worn. Another make for Head Chubby is this hoodie. You might be aware of that because I made a tutorial for cover stitch, how to make the pockets, and the pockets are here. So these are sort of patch pockets. I mean, I use the lining of the pocket from the pattern, and the pattern is New Look 6588. Changed a lot because I was talking about this pattern in another video, so I'm not going to talk about it now. I like certain things, but it was huge, so I sized it down now and I made it shorter, despite the fact that Hedgehubby is 6'3" or 6'4". He never really tells me. More 4 than 3. 6'4", let's say. I mean, it's not that he doesn't tell me. He's got this joke that I'm sick of. He always says, well, I'm 6'3" or 6'4", because when you are tall, 1 inch doesn't really matter. I would do everything to add an inch to how tall I am or how short I am. That's the hoodie. And for some reason it looks see-through because I've got really bright lights kind of directed at the hoodie. It's not see-through. I don't know why in my tutorial it looked quite see-through. So there is this overlapping color and it's quite cool, I think. Well, as I said, I've changed it quite a lot because I added cuffs made of ribbing and I added the bottom band made of ribbing. I just prefer it like that, so it's more like something that I would usually make. And the pockets, and the pockets are finished with ribbing as well. This fabric was from Colville, so it was cheap. It's kind of scuba-like. And Hedgehubby, for some reason, really likes skulls. I don't understand the strange fascination with skulls and decay. And if I want to see something like that, I would watch TV. He hasn't seen it yet, so I don't know if he likes it, because it's a present for Christmas. So I'm going to put it under the tree as well. And when we are at Sewing for Men, I'm going to show you something. I make loads and loads and loads of them because I use scraps. I've never shown you any of my dog jackets or dog t-shirts or coats or whatever. So I'm going to show you something that I made for Brian, for my dog Brian. He's got a matching snood. Brian had tonsillitis. His immune system is not the greatest ever, so he needs to have his throat protected all the time. He gets all colds and infections very easily, so pretty much all the time he does wear either a bandana or a scarf or a kind of snood. He's wearing the matching snood now, and he's not here, strangely enough. Normally he always is, and you can probably hear him quite often. Brian is my dog, just mine, because Lily is more a family dog. Brian is a bit weird. Brian is a reactive dog, and I love him to bits, and I'm probably the only person in the world who really loves him, and he really loves me. That's the jacket for my baby Brian. It's got ribbing added. Of course, it's got a lot of finishes with the cover stitch. It's got lining, slippery ITY lining, like that, because I want the slippery bit against his hair. And it's really warm because it's heavy scuba crepe. See? The back of, so the wrong side of the scuba crepe has got a sort of mesh. So it is really, really, really warm. And that's it. And I make loads of them, and I never really thought I would show you, but then why not? Because if you have a dog and if you think that your dog is getting cold, this is self-drafted, because Brian is funny shape. So it's very easy to draft something for your dog, and it's very easy to use your scraps. And if your dog decides that he or she likes it, why not? Even if you line it, it takes about an hour to sew, an hour to cut out, because you have to measure the dog. That's not always the easiest thing in the world. I think it's pretty cool. Everything is finished with the ribbing, and I liked the fact that it's contrasting. I didn't want it to be super fancy. He does have some that are kind of really fun. I hope you enjoyed my male edition of the vlog. Thank you very much for watching, and see you soon. Bye.